Hola, sean bienvenidos al séptimo vicio de tu programa de cine en Vía X. Nadie sale indemne, sale indiferente a bordo de los viajes interestelares que suponen discos como Undertow, Aenima, Lateralus, 10,000 Days. Para nosotros, son como los Enterprises, los Falcon Millennium, son los Sankokai, los cruceros espaciales imperiales de la música que tanto nos gusta. Para mí, Tool es como cuando Luke Skywalker ingresa al sistema Dagobah y conoce a Yoda. Eso significa un universo completamente nuevo. Y encontrarse por primera vez, hace ya varios años, más de una década, con discos como Opiate o Undertow, suponía también una especie de peregrinación iniciática por Tatooine. En fin, música, transporte para viajeros musicales. Eso es Tool. ¿La alfombra mágica de la que hablaba Mazapán? Sí, pero en peyote, con incienso y fumándolo a tal concho. Algunos nos encontramos con Opiate, Undertow o Aenima como por azar en nuestras vidas, y la verdad terminamos abrazados a ellos por necesidad. Por eso nos nombramos siempre con mayúsculas en nuestro cuatro letras favorito, Tool. Para los más superficiales, es el tatuaje que tiene Cristian Castro. Para nosotros, una manera de vivir. Desde este martes, 6 de octubre, hasta el martes de la próxima semana, 13 de octubre, sean bienvenidos a un especial espacial de Tool. Lo hemos llamado la antología, en nuestro séptimo vicio redentor. Y ahí está el blog del séptimo vicio en www.vx.cl/séptimo vicio, donde siempre tratamos distintos temas, pero quisiera no solamente exponer mi perspectiva, que la puedes leer sobre Tool, sino también escuchar la tuya. Les propongo un intercambio de palabras, emociones, perspectivas. En fin, creo que ahí se va a congregar una mezcla de colores, que al fin y al cabo es el prisma de la vida con la banda sonora de Tool. Y además vas a encontrar un concurso muy especial y dedicado solamente a ustedes. Sean bienvenidos al séptimo vicio. Es el documental The Ultimate Review sobre Tool, más otras sorpresas. Sean bienvenidos.
How does the break the mold of a traditional rock show or that of traditional cabaret theater?
Doesn't really. Lee lied about all that. However, Gigi Allen possibly will materialize long enough to re-kill himself for entertainment, maybe. Puzzle that one out.
So what bores you about traditional rock shows?
The rock part, honestly. I actually prefer the nightlife, and I prefer to boogie.
Do you think that to create something that, you know, pushes boundaries, challenges people, breaks the mold, that you have to break a few rules and potentially offend the mainstream audience?
Are you referring to our Date Rape Made Fun campaign?
Yeah.
Yeah, that didn't go so well.
So how would you describe First Sense of Humor?
Not very humorous, which in its own way is kind of humorous. Just not to anybody who really truly gets, likes, or enjoys comedy.
So is ever misunderstood? And if so, why do you think that is? Are people just slow?
Most of our jokes are retooled from Spanish Sunday comics, so a bit of the humor gets lost in the translation. But I just think that we're just not very funny.
Does the music of necessitate or demand like a multimedia performance in order to be fully realized on stage?
Yeah, Hollywood's full of lemmings, so we'll do whatever it takes to get them to pretend they get it. Even if it means spending tens of dollars. So you can just get in here because my my boss or my supervisor might be going by, and if he sees me out here dicking around, I'm gonna get reprimanded and lose my donut privileges. Yeah, we're gonna do whatever it takes to get these people to pretend they get it, even if that means spending tens of dollars on some version of the King's new clothes. We can walk right down Sunset Boulevard fully nudist, and they'll follow because that's what they do.
Distinctive, uncompromising, intelligent, experimental, and original, American four-piece Tool are one of the most startling and innovative bands in the world today. Coming up to their second decade in action, their career so far has encompassed elements of heavy metal, prog, electronica, and dark psychedelia, creating a body of work that is testament to their incredible talent, undying musical integrity, and forceful imagination.
We're looking at the end times through this dark, rhythmic, powerful, freeform, conceptual kind of music.
It's like, wow, my God, these are great songs. You know, they were great from the second that they had started, you know.
The studio environment was as exciting as I'd been with any musicians. I mean, working with these guys, I realized very quickly that they were all extremely good musicians, and so that was thrilling.
They had such a strong sense of self, you know, and such a deep belief in what they were doing and the feedback they were getting from everybody, that I think it was okay for them to do something different.
In the late 1980s, the four future members of Tool all moved to Los Angeles to pursue their original ambitions. Singer Maynard James Keenan would relocate from Ohio, drummer Danny Carey from Kansas, guitarist Adam Jones from Illinois, and initial bassist Paul DeMoor from Washington. At the time, the City of Angels was ruled by a musical fad that was as far away from the challenging music Tool would eventually produce as possible. Since the mid-80s, LA had largely been dominated by glam metal, Sunset Strip rockers who valued their over-the-top theatrics as much as their musical ability. Although the scene had passed its peak by the time a new decade was beginning, it still seemed to be the prevalent force in American rock music, helped in no small part by the cultural ubiquity of superstars Guns N' Roses.
In Los Angeles in the late 80s, it was just all the mix of girl glam and some of the bands that were kind of similar to Guns N' Roses, the Junkyards and Asphalt Ballets and Tricks and Circus. Just a crazy time. It was everyone wanted to be the next Motley Crue or the next Guns N' Roses.
I loved what was going on. I mean, I was right there, hair metal, thousands of people on the Sunset Strip. Never going home. I ate it up, but it was certainly really exciting while it was going on. You know, 17 and no rules, and like, it was just a massive, crazy party.
The late 80s and the early 90s in Los Angeles were the most loud, decadent, culture-shocking period, essentially, in rock and roll over the last two decades. You had Guns N' Roses, who'd come out of the Motley Crue, who'd come out of the area and Sunset Boulevard. you could point to the to this area as being the vortex of a scene of music that was being accepted far beyond the bounds of Los Angeles. Tool's early records were born out of that same musical sort of fabric, aggressive, groundbreaking sort of music, but they weren't attached to a geography.
The first inklings of the individuality and nonconformity that would come to define Tool arose through the work of another band. Born in Buffalo, Bill Manspeaker was another recent arrival to Los Angeles. His band, Green Jello, a comedy metal collective named after the food people would throw at them during gigs, had become a fixture of the Hollywood underground music scene. Expanding the number of members, they would, for a short while, recruit both future Tool pioneers Danny Carey and Maynard James Keenan. It would be a fitting early start for artists so resolutely out of the ordinary.
And Adam and Maynard were friends. And I had this big gigantic loft that we all lived in Hollywood, and Maynard just needed a place to live. He just moved into town, and I was like, yeah, sure, you know, come on over here. And he immediately joined Green Jello, and, you know, he was one of the singers, and Danny Carey was the drummer in the band, and we used to have our own parties at our studio. And, you know, one day Maynard was just tired of working at the pet store, and he said, you know what, let me make up a band for the party, and maybe I'll get signed to this $300,000 record deal.
Green Jello, later rebranded Green Jelly, would persevere with their less-than-serious artistic stance and would go on to see substantial success. Maynard and Danny had moved on by this point, however, and in 1990, the first incarnation of Tool had officially come together, a state of affairs which bore witness to perfect timing. A change in cultural consensus would soon mean that not fitting into the glam metal scene would be a very smart move. In the early 90s, the record-buying audience grew tired of Hairspray and histrionics and were looking for something with more substance.
Well, what do you think about interviews?
What do I think?
Really Did you hear my reaction when he asked me if I wanted to do one?
Yeah.
I said, fuck no. Yeah. I said, heck no.
An alternative rock resurgence began, spearheaded by grunge band Nirvana, whose massive success purveyed an unmistakable call to arms. It was okay to be angry, it was okay to be intelligent, and it was okay to be different. To a young group like Tool, this new American musical landscape was an open door to opportunity.
That whole thing came up. I mean, you could feel that surge of something different, and I mean, it all escalated in around 90, end of 91 with Nirvana. I mean, that set the tone for the acceptance of those bands. Around the end of 91, it was, you know, you were seeing bands like Fishbone and Primus, but definitely once Nirvana hit, that kind of music became more accepting, and it shut the door. I know it's cliche to say this, it's been said so many times, but it did shut the door on those Warrants and the Skid Rows and the Poisons that were definitely prevalent in 1990. And after 91, after October 91, that stuff was, you know.
I could definitely see the importance. You know, if you're emerging and you're doing something new and, you know, you're looking for reasons to believe in it, you know, more than what's going on already, you know, it was quite different. And I don't think a lot of outside forces necessarily believed in it. So I think it was probably an advantage to the people who, you know, had sort of just moved on so rapidly. I mean, like Pearl Jam, Nirvana, like all that sort of Seattle, the grunge, I mean, couldn't be any more different than what was going on.
In the early days, Tool were compared to Nirvana because Nirvana was, of course, the big thing that was going on, the breakthrough music of the time. And Tool had some elements of loud, aggressive music and teenage angst and artistic delivery. There were certain parallels, and it was an interesting place for the band to be in. At the same time, they never really felt like they were part of that, and they never really felt like part of anything, which was really, I think, to their benefit, because they've always been able to kind of transcend what's going on around them and just kind of create their own thing while still tapping into elements of what works and what's popular and what they like.
Tool wasted no time in making a name for themselves. Gigging heavily and putting together a demo tape, it only took a couple of months for them to attract a significant following.
They recorded their first demo on a four-track, you know, on a little cassette, handwritten. You know, they recorded four songs, and, you know, he played them for me. I was like, wow, my God, these are great songs. You know, they were great from the second that they had started, you know. You didn't have to lie about it, you know, when you tell your friends, oh, it was a great song, you know. They were really good songs, and, you know, and I played the hell out of that cassette. I'd bring it to work, and I'd play it, and everybody at work loved it. And you just had a party. And Tool played at the party at the house, you know. We had a keg and everybody was drinking. And some of my friends from the record company came over that I knew.
They actually got the deal from the record label after playing 7 or 8 gigs because their shows were so outlandish and so different than everything else that was going on. So even if the A&R people didn't understand what they were trying to do, they knew that they were onto something different.
With the attention of record company executive Snared, Tool signed to Zoo Entertainment. And it was in March 1992 that they unveiled their debut release, an EP entitled Opiate. This short, 6-song introduction to the world of the band would lay down the framework for what was to be a remarkable creative journey.
The editor of Rip Magazine, I got invited up to Zoo Entertainment, and I was in an office. Lou Malia, he was the president of the company, and everybody at that time wanted me to hear their stuff early. And he closed his doors and he put on that Opiate. Like, this is what we got, Lon. You know, you write about metal, your magazine's the best. And he played me that. I mean, that's early. That's before all the texture and evolution came to Tool, but you could hear.
Marshall Trimble, official Arizona State historian. Right alongside the Verde River in Pound of Jerome. It became a ghost town for a while. Then a man named Maynard Keenan in the mid-1990s came out to the wickedest city in the West, and there he met up with Eric Kolomsky. By golly, they started growing grapes.
No one in their right mind would plant a vineyard that's less than 6 acres just because financially it's just as easy to farm 100 acres as it is to farm 10 acres. So to farm a half an acre is just kind of silly.
You know, my perception of winemaking is that it helps humans get closer to the earth, especially if it's ushered to them in a way where they understand this wine came from here and that's why it tastes this way and why it smells this way. The more we appreciate something, the more apt we are to preserve it, protect it, and interact with it in a more positive way.
I had a dream about being in Arizona, and I had no real interest in moving to Arizona. Just, of course, the first criticism that people have, isn't it a desert, isn't it full of cactuses and, you know, cement? And the answer is not necessarily up here. And I fell in love with it right away, and it didn't take long for me to start having visions of grapes on these slopes.
Arizona's my home, and my wines are an expression of a place that I call home. Today we're bottling Caduceus Premier Passo. This was the first wine Maynard ever conceived here with me at Page Spring Cellars. Tasting wine, testing barrels, putting blends together, that's all this artistic stuff. It's a lot of fun. Bottling is kind of the process that every winemaker rues.
We want to welcome Maynard James Keenan and Eric Glomsky, founders of the Arizona Stronghold Vineyards, here today.
When you guys are picking the grapes, what exactly are you looking for?
It's like writing a song. You just want to let the sounds happen in a room and go with it. Whatever Arizona on this particular spot on the globe wants to offer up for flavors, that's what we're going to do. We let the grapes speak for itself.
Not only are we on a frontier here with regards to, you know, Arizona, but we're on kind of a frontier here with viticulture, expressing this place that is Maynard's Vineyard.
The location is special. The vineyard itself is special. It's worth taking the risk, basically.
Si hay grupos que son genuinamente imposibles de describir de manera común y normal, tanto por la música como por las emociones que nos hacen sortear, entonces creo que Tool forma parte de una raza perdida y extinguida dentro del panorama musical. Para mí es como un buen retiro a nuestro monasterio en las montañas. A veces hay que escuchar, hay que tener una dosis de Tool, ojalá cotidiana, para volver al valle de la imaginación, cuando te sientas estresado y cierras los ojos en busca de un lugar íntimo donde puedes escuchar a tu verdadero yo. Tienes que pisar el freno, detenerte en el camino, salir del vehículo, dejar los fierros, las máquinas, la metalurgia atrás y respirar hondamente. Creo que Tool en el fondo nos ayuda a encontrar el camino de la vida con un rumbo más definido. Escuchar a Tool para mí significa aclarar todas mis emociones, despejar las nubes, los nubarrones. Y ahora quiero romper todo protocolo televisivo porque Tool a su vez rompe con todas las normas establecidas musicales. Y terminar este primer capítulo del séptimo vicio, recuerda, hoy martes 7 de octubre hasta el martes 13 de octubre, documentales más los videos que ha realizado históricamente el séptimo vicio. Pero además te queremos hacer regalo de esta camisa oficial de Tool en www.vx.cl/séptimo vicio. Solo adquiriéndola formarás parte de esta secta, de esta religión llamada Tool. www.vx.cl/séptimo vicio. Nos vemos mañana miércoles. Recuerda que durante algunas semanas el séptimo vicio tomará lugar desde los martes hasta el viernes con capítulos de resúmenes durante el fin de semana. Ya lo sabes, tu semana cultural parte entonces el martes y termina el domingo con el séptimo vicio. Los espero mañana con más Tool y el segundo y fenomenal episodio.
Major Douche, we'll be taking your questions now. Please keep your questions tailored to the specific campaign at hand, and please keep them brief.
You, sir.
Now, from what we understand, this is, what can we expect from this Pucifier show? Now, we know it has been deemed as a cabaret show, and that's the first part of my question. The second part of my question is, we know there's music, what else can we expect?
Chaos. Pure chaos, sprinkled with significant collateral damage, which by most calculations are within the acceptable margins.
You, sir.
Yes, thank you. Who is in the live incarnation of Pucifer, and what performers are lined up for the shows? Which ones? For all the shows.
We have gone to great lengths to recruit the best
of the best
of the best
of the best
of the best. But unfortunately, the best of the best
of the best
of the best were either already employed or would not return our call. So we were forced to recruit from a pool of the morally ambiguous.
Morally ambiguous.
That pool includes Ms. Laura Milligan, Mr. Maynard Keenan.
Keenan.
Tim Alexander.
Matt Mitchell. Johnny Polonsky.
Johnny Polonsky.
Julie Camagheri. Mila Jovovich.
Gil and Ronnie Sharon.
Jackie Harris. Paul Greenberg.
Jill Talley. Tom Kenny.
Jeff Friedel. Mavic Junkins.
Basically just a bunch of bad seeds. You, ma'am. Sir.
General, Major Douche, will each night be different? Are there themes?
This campaign will be diverse and without logic.
Without logic.
We'll be using all available resources, including but not limited to
shock, awe,
shock,
awe,
shock,
awe,
shock,
and some more awe,
shock, and more awe.
And although we are underfunded, we are well trained. We will do our best to reach the target and emerge victorious before our last call has been announced.
What are the ticket prices?
As we know all too well, freedom is not free. The price for freedom during this campaign will be $39.
$39.
$39 per night, plus tax, tip, valet, cab, minibar slots,
hookers,
and drinks.
Mixed and otherwise.
And by slots, I mean slots. You, sir.
How long will the shows be?
This war must continue until every man, woman, and child have had a taste of my freedom. We've gathered the intel, we've analyzed the data, so roughly speaking, 2 hours? You, sir?
Major douche.
You, sir, with the hair.
Is there a name for these shows? A name for these shows? Please answer my question.
Negative.
Hey, how's it going? Bro, listen, will Tool be recording a new album anytime soon? And if so, has writing begun on that project? I was wondering about that.
That's classified.
Also, hey, will any members of Tool be on hand? That's a good question. Any members of Tool be on hand?
That's classified, dickhead.
You uptight, bro.
And go yourself. Listen here, you little pansy. You don't know from Shinola. Sucker! Speak up, son. You're burning daylight.
God! Also, listen, is there any possibility that Perfect Circle might be reuniting in the near future? Right? Come on. Answer that!
That's classified, and if you continue this line of questioning, men in dark suits will show up to your residence and detain you for what will seem like tens of minutes. Cease, and desist. Thank you, and God speed.
Are you finished with that wine, or?
Grab the wine.